A very good evening to all of you. Today from CCI, we have a very special webinar on allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, a condition which we know is very common, very perplexing, easy to diagnose, but at times also very difficult to perceive that the patient is actually suffering from ABPA. So in order to enlighten all of us on ABPA, we have a very, very special panel today, which is being moderated by none other than our CCI Dr. KS Satish sir, our patron. He is a consultant pulmonologist at Fortis Hospital, Bangalore and Manipal Hospital, Miller Road, Bangalore. Truly a legend who requires very little introduction. Today, a presentation on ABPA will be given by none other than Dr. Shweta Bansal, who is Senior Consultant Interventional Pulmonologist from the Delhi Heart and Lung Institute, Delhi. Our very own in-house CCI radiologist, Dr. Nikhil Gupta, will be talking about the radiological manifestations of ABPA, and he is currently a consultant radiologist at Fortis Hospital, Mohali. And in order to enlighten us on a lot of aspects of ABPA, we have Dr. Abhay, Uppe sir, who is professor and head of the unit pulmonary medicine DY Patil Hospital, Navi, Mumbai. And sir is also a pulmonologist at Apollo Hospital, Belapur. In order to introduce all of them and also throw some light about aspergillosis, you have me, Dr. Ravi Dosi. I'm CCI National Secretary and I'm currently Professor and Head of the Department, Aurobindo Institute, Indore. So, I would like to begin with an introduction of aspergillus. What is aspergillus actually? So, aspergillus is a mold which is seen everywhere, is present everywhere, and is actually affecting almost practically every living being on this planet Earth. Aspergillus species can be seen anywhere from the nooks and corners of our home to our air conditioners. It is a ubiquitous saprophytic mold which is having an essential role in the recycling of carbon and nitrogen in our atmosphere. It has a simple biological cycle, a very high sporulating capacity, more conidia at high concentration of 100 per meter cube. Aspergillus conidia are very small, 2 to 3 microns in diameter, so they are very easily penetrable into the alveoli. In immunocompetent patients, the conidia may be inhaled, but they are also exhaled, so they themselves act as a potential source of spreading them. These conidia or these aspergillus species are very rapidly growing hardy molds. You can identify them on the several culture plates over here, and they have conidia. They are acute angle septate hyphae, almost 45 degrees. They can be isolated from several specimen by KOH, PAS and gomorrhimethamine stain. The aspergillus family is a big family. They have almost 200 aspergillus species, of which around more than 20 are pathogenic to humans. Aspergillus fumigatus is the most common of the found species, which causes hypersensitivity reactions in humans. Aspergillus flavus is isolated and is known to have amphotericin B resistance. Aspergillus niger, which you can all see because most of the onions which we go are having this black sort of mold attached to it. So this is none other than Aspergillus niger sakshat. Then you have Aspergillus terius, which is amphotericin B resistant. And you have Aspergillus nidulans, which is very infamous to cause a lot of invasive disease and is also amphotericin B resistance. Now, aspergillus has several virulence factors. When these conidia or these hyphae sporulate, they are inhaled by the individual and they penetrate into the lung parenchyma, thereby attacking the respiratory epithelium, that is conidial germination in absence of sufficient pulmonary defenses, which can be anything. It can be an iatrogenic lapse in defense, or it can be neutropenia causing excessive hyphal growth and dissemination. These aspergillus virulence factors in turn, like gliotoxin, helvolic acid, fumigline, affect the mucociliary clearance. They cause direct destruction and necrosis of the airway epithelium. They damage the basement membrane. The serine proteases and other proteases attack the alveolar epithelium. The Aspergillus fungus has a lot of virulence factors. It is a very, very potent fungal and infective agent. Some other or very prominent virulence factors are gliotoxin, which causes a lot of activation of proteases, elastases, phospholipases, leading to tissue invasion and nutrient acquisition by the fungus. It causes activation of the reactive oxygenation species through catalases and superoxide dismutases. Then there is beta-1,3-glucan, which can be also used as a diagnostic tool for Aspergillus. And then there is melanin, which again causes oxidative stimulation. The host, which is immunocompetent, who is immunocompetent, also will evoke an immune response to Aspergillus. It can be an immediate response in the form of alveolar macrophages or tissue-resident macrophages and chemokines, or there can be the two waves of recruited cells. First is the wave of rapidly recruited cells in which there are neutrophils, and then there is a second wave of recruited cells in which there are monocyte-derived dendritic cells of myeloid origin. There are mast cells, eosinophils, and natural killer cells. But these Aspergillus species, usually in normal immunity, are covered by a layer called as hydrophobins. These hydrophobins are responsible for the lung penetration of the Aspergillus species, because these hydrophobins don't allow the pathogenic, the virulence factor, to be nulled by the host defense organisms. So if the patient is immunocompetent, even if the Aspergillus will go up to the level of alveoli, these hydrophobins will not let the virulence factors affect the Aspergillus fungi. So the broad spectrum of Aspergillus disease is basically dependent hugely on the immune response of the host. It can either be an hypersensitivity allergy, in which ABPA is there, which is also the topic of today's talk, which Dr. Ma'am will be elaborating very detailed way. Then if the patient is having a structural disease or an inflammatory disease, then there can be aspergilloma or pulmonary aspergillosis, chronic pulmonary aspergillosis, which are the semi-invasive forms. If the patient is having a severe immunodeficiency, then there can be invasive pulmonary aspergillosis or even extrapulmonary manifestations of aspergillosis. The spectrum of pulmonary aspergillosis depends on immunity to a very large extent and also on the underlying lung architecture. If there is a normal immune status and the patient is suffering from COPD, then it can have just simple colonization, it will not do anything. If there is a hypersensitivity reaction, so it can cause allergic bronchial asthma, ABPA, bronchocentric granulomatosis, or extrinsic allergic alveolitis. But suppose if there is a pre-existing cavity in the lung, then there will be an aspergilloma, a saprophytic growth of the Aspergillus, in which the normal immune status may be there, but the pre-existing cavity will be infected by the Aspergillus species. Suppose if the patient is immunosuppressed, then there will be a lot of invasive infection. There can be invasive bronchial aspergillosis, particularly in lung transplant patients with a high degree of tissue invasion. There can be bronchial stump aspergillosis, in which although the immune status may be normal, it can happen in pneumonectomy patients. And then you have chronic pulmonary aspergillosis, in which immune status is suppressed. It can happen in COPD cases. You can have invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, in which immune status is extremely suppressed. You have a normal underlying lung architecture, but after this particular infection, there is a huge degree of tissue invasion. So you can see that this Aspergillus species causes a spectrum of diseases. Today, we will be concentrating on allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. And now I would like to request Dr. Shweta ma'am to begin her presentation and give a talk on allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. First, I would like to thank CCI and Dr. Ravi and Dr. Krishna for giving me this opportunity. So not without wasting any time, I would like to come to my topic, and again would like to thank Dr. Ravi for giving me, telling the basics, the initial basics of ABPA, and I would further elaborate on various other aspects of this entity, which is called allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, ABPA. So just a little bit of introduction that ABPA is a very under-recognized entity. A lot of patients of obstructive airway disease comes to us. Every second or third patient is an asthma patient or a COPD patient. But we do not look for ABPA in these patients. And as high as 30% of these patients are misdiagnosed as pulmonary tuberculosis because of the overlapping features, especially the constitutional symptoms with which they present. And even in asthma patients also, a lot of patients do get undetected for as long as 10 years. So when the patient is undetected for last 10 years, it ends up in having type 2 respiratory failure, type 1 respiratory failure, and having complications of ABP. So early recognition of ABP is very, very important. And the screening of the patients at the OPD level, at the initial levels in stage 0 or 1 is very important. So we'll talk about this in further in the next 15 minutes. So if we talk about the prevalence of ABP, it's very common. It's in cystic fibrosis, the prevalence is about 9%. And if we look in the prevalence of ABPA in asthma, in referral centers, it's as high as 13%. According to the GINA guidelines, the total asthma cases of 193 million cases are there worldwide, out of which 5 million cases are being diagnosed as ABPA with a prevalence of 2.5%. So this much is a burden of ABPA in patients of asthma, which most of which may get undiagnosed, which may go undetected. And in India, about 1.4 million cases are prevalent in every year. And if we look at this data, which is looks into the epidemiology in the last 10 years, most of these studies are from India. And the prevalence of ABPA, you can see, is as high as 22%. And one of the studies is as high as 70%. So ABPA is very prevalent disease. And another entity that is aspergillus sensitization is there, which is the presence of type 1 hypersensitivity reaction, that is skin prick test is positive or the specific IgG against aspergillus is positive. It is as high as 30 to 40%. So though both these entities are different, but recognition of these in OPD basis as well as IPD patients is very important. And the management, managing these patients is also very important. But as we see, the burden of both these aspergillus sensitization and ABPA is quite high. And generally, the predisposing conditions that we think of are the asthma and cystic fibrosis. But in the last few years, COPD as well as post-tubercular fibrocavitary diseases, there has been a lot of case reports as well as case series, which have found that in these patients of COPD and fibrocavitary disease, a lot of ABPA has been found. And that's why in the latest ISHAM criteria, they have been included as the predisposing factor. Environmental factors also play a very important role, but this article, which was published in 2014 by Dr. Ritesh and his team, found that the living conditions, that is a home environment, presence of moisture, etc., they were noted equally among the ABPA as well as the bronchial asthma patient, except that the ABPA was found more in the rural areas. So environmental factors may not be the primary pathogenic factors. They may be causative factors, they may be supporting as a risk factor, but they are not the primary pathogenic factors. The main is the genetic predisposition, the innate immunity, and the various polymorphism that are occurring at the cellular and the tissue level, which are involved in the pathophysiology of ABPA. So the most important question in front of us is when to suspect ABPA. A patient has come to us. The most clinching clue is the patient of asthma who is poorly controlled. Even on adequate treatment, the compliance is good, patient is taking inhalers, but still the asthma is not getting controlled. This is the most important feature that should tickle your mind, that yes, I have to look for ABPA in such patients. The patient may give history of wheezing, the patient may give history of hemoptysis and expectoration of brownish black mucus plugs. This is because of the bronchiectasis and the fungi that are present there. And the patient may present with non-specific symptoms, the constitutional symptoms of fever, weight loss, malaise, and fatigue, which very easily are being confused with tuberculosis. So the poorly controlled asthma is the most important feature that we should be looking, we should be vigilant about. And in such patients, we should always screen and investigate for ABPA. Few of the patients may be asymptomatic, so you may look for other examination findings as well as the lab parameters of eosinophilia or markedly high IgE levels, in which you need to be to carefully screen for such patients. On examination, apart from finding features of asthma and bronchiectasis, you may find clubbing, which is because of the end stage disease, the patient has progressed a lot. Or in asthma patients, when you find that the patient is developing pulmonary hypertension, the patient has atelectasis or other radiological features, which we'll be discussing later on. These are there. This should also trigger you for the screening for ABPA. So when you want to screen for ABPA, when you want to diagnose, but there are array of tests are available. There are many tests available, which to do, when to do, we will be discussing in brief now, as well as in panel discussion, we will have a detailed discussion. So first test is the aspergillus skin test, which is immediate cutaneous hypersensitivity. That is a type 1 test. So for a long time, it has been advocated as a screening tool for ABPA, that the test is negative, the ABPA is ruled out. But a very good article that has been published by Ritesh Agarwal and team from PGI, which looks into the diagnostic performance of various tests, has shown that the sensitivity of this skin test is 94%. So a good screening tool is the one which has a very high sensitivity. It should be 100% sensitive so that we are not able to miss. So so with skin test also, 6 to 12% of ABPA patient can still be missed. And the sensitive, if we look at the specificity, it's 79%. So few of the patients of asthma who are not having ABPA may still have a positive test. So the specificity is less, but sensitivity is also not very good. And the next test that is we are going to talk about is a specific IgE. This is a very important test in the for making the diagnosis, because this is a very sensitive test. The same article shows a sensitivity of about 100%. Though the specificity has decreased a bit, but the sensitivity is very good, as high as 100%. So the Isham group has proposed this specific IgE levels more than 0.25 to be a very good test to rule out ABPA and can be used for screening. But the only disadvantage of this test is that it cannot be used for follow-up, because even in patients who are having clinical radiological improvement, the still specific IgE may be high or vice versa. So it's not a good test for follow-up, but it is a very good screening test for further evaluation of ABPA. The next important test is total IgE. This is a very common test that we routinely do, and this is the test which was initially, and in most of the postgraduates also think that this might be the good screening tool. But no, as we have discussed, specific IgE against aspergillus is the best screening tool. But yes, total IgE when high, you should always look for. And the cutoff values are a bit controversial. Different cutoffs have been proposed, have been discussing. The IgE levels more than 1000 has a sensitivity of 97%, though the specificity is 37. But when the cutoff of 417 is taken, this specificity is further reduced to 24%. So the HM group have recommended more than 1000 international unit per ml as a criteria for inclusion in for the diagnostic criteria for ABPA. So it's a good sensitive test, but still the specificity is low. But the good thing about this test is that it can be used for the follow-up. It can be used to objectively say that the patient is in response, patient is having response, or patient is in exacerbation. Next test is total eosinophil count, which is a very non-specific findings. A lot of patients with asthma as well as ABPA may have a lot of high peripheral blood eosinophil count. And it is a poor screening test, but yes, if the count is too high, then it just gives us a bell that yes, you may need to evaluate further. And Isham group has recommended AEC level more than 500 as a cutoff for the diagnosis of ABPA. The next important test is the serum precipitin or the specific IgG against aspergillus. So for the past few decades, serum precipitin was a very important investigation tool, but the recent few studies in the last few years have shown that the sensitivity of aspergillus precipitin is only 27%. As compared to the specific IgG, which is a surrogate marker for this, the sensitivity is 89%. So along with sensitivity of specificity of 100%, so sensitivity is also high and specificity is also high. So it's a good rule-in test. I'm talking about specific IgG. So specific IgE has now overruled the serum precipitin, and the latest Isham proposed criteria have removed serum precipitin from the diagnostic criteria, and only specific IgE has been included because of its good sensitivity as well as specificity. So we have these tests in our hand, but there has been a lot of confusion regarding how many criteria to be taken into account, which criteria to be taken into account, minor, major. there has been a lot of paradigm shift in the last few decades regarding these criteria. The one which we traditionally have been reading are the Rosenberg and the Peterson criteria. So, which included the major criteria are 8 in number. Out of these 8, 6 must be present for definitive diagnosis of ABP. And the minor criteria are the supportive ones. So, asthma, transient pulmonary infiltrate, skin prick test, total IgE, specific IgGE, the precipitin, eosinophilia, and central bronchiectasis. These are the major criteria out of which 6 should be present. These were further upgraded by Greenberger, giving the minimal essential criteria and the truly minimal essential criteria. But in the last decade, we have now Isham group, which has proposed ABPA working group criteria that was proposed in 2013, which have been further modified in 2016. So this group has recommended that in a patient who has predisposing conditions of bronchial asthma and cystic fibrosis, you must have 2 essential criteria. One is either the specific IgE or skin test, and the other is the increased total IgE levels. Along with the additional criteria, out of these 3, 2 must be present. Either number 1 is the presence of precipitating antibodies or specific IgE against aspergillus. The second one are the thoracic imaging consistent with ABP, and third one are the eosinophilia. But again, in 2016, they revised the criteria and included COPD and post-TB fibrocavitary as the predisposing condition. They removed skin prick test and the serum precipitin. As I had discussed, the sensitivity of both of these tests was less as compared to their surrogate, that is specific IgE and specific IgG against aspergillus. So both of these tests have been removed. So now, on the basis of these newly proposed criteria by Isham, these are being followed worldwide, and we are diagnosing ABPA on the basis of these diagnostic criteria. Apart from these, because there is lot of variations in the values as well as the cutoff values, so Isham group has also recommended for, they have also proposed scoring systems, which is based on the immunological score based on the various blood tests, that is, these are the blood tests, and on the basis of the values, they have proposed scores. And on the basis of the HRCT findings, they have again, scoring is there, normal is 0. And further on the radiology. So if the patient is having normal CT scan, but the score of 8, then he is at risk for ABPA. But with the score of 0, but radiological score of 0, but total score more than 9, then ABPA-S is diagnosed. That is serological ABPA. But when the patient has some more 2 or more than 2 radiological score, then we have other features of radiology, which we'll be discussing in the next presentation. So on these basis, scoring is being done. So once you have a patient, you have diagnosed the patients, you need to stage the patient, which stage the patient is in, so that you can properly manage the patient and you can properly follow the patient. Earlier staging that was proposed by Peterson, there were 5 stages, but they were very subjective. There was very less objective parameters there. So the latest Isham recommendations have been there, who have which have suggested 6 stages for ABPA. The stage 0 is the asymptomatic stage, when you have newly diagnosed ABPA patient, but the asthma is controlled. The second, the stage 1 is the acute stage, when you have newly diagnosed ABPA, but the patient is having symptoms, there is uncontrolled asthma, the patient is having constitutional symptoms. When this is with mucoid infection, this is 1A. Without mucoid infection, it is 1B. Then you have a response when there is, along with clinical and radiological improvement, there is fall in the IgE level by more than 25%. Exacerbation is defined when there is worsening clinical radiologically with IgE level more than 50% from the previous baseline. Remission is that when the patient is responded and you have stopped the you are stopped the therapy for 6 months, and then there is sustained clinical radiological improvement. So then the patient is called remission. But most of the patient may respond and may become treatment dependent also. In treatment dependent, you have to specify whether the patient is dependent, treatment dependent because of ABPA or because of asthma. Because when the patient has clinical deterioration, but there is no radiological deterioration, there is no immunological, IgE levels are not raised, then you can fairly say that this, there is no ABPA exacerbation due to ABPA, but this is because of asthma. But when there is immunological deterioration as well as radiological deterioration along with the clinical, then you say that it is treatment dependent ABPA. The 6th stage is advanced ABPA, when the complications, the end stage complications are there. The patient has landed up in cold pulmonary, chronic type 2 respiratory failure. There is extensive bronchiectasis. So once diagnosed, you should always try to stage the patients because it will help you for the management and for the follow-up of the patient. So this is a diagnostic algorithm. Once you have suspected bronchial asthma, you should always screen with specific IgE. And if it is high, then you should screen with other serological tests and radiology of the patient and then categorize the patient on the basis of radiology as well as the staging. This is a radiological classification that has been proposed by the Isham group. We'll be discussing in the next presentation by Dr. Nikhil. The other tests that may be done are the sputum cultures, which may grow Aspergillus fumigatus, but this is not very specific for a diagnostic for ABPA. The pulmonary function test, which may help in classifying the severity of the disease. And very importantly, galactomannan detection, which is very important, which plays a very important role for the diagnosis of invasive aspergillosis. But for the diagnosis of ABPA, the sensitivity is only 25% with specificity of 82%. Both BAL and serum have a limited value, limited utility for the diagnosis of ABPA, and it's not generally recommended if you are suspecting ABPA. There are other newer tests like basophil activation test, which has shown promising results in the diagnosis of CA, CF-related ABPA, and recombinant aspergillus antigens and engineered allergens to detect the specific IgE, NG against aspergillus to prevent the cross-reactivity. But these are not easily available and they have not come in the guidelines yet. So once you have diagnosed the patient, you have staged the patients, we have to manage the patients. So the goal of management, the treatment should be the control of symptoms of the patients, the control of the acute stage of ABPA. And more importantly, to control the control and treatment of exacerbations. And obviously the most important to prevent the patient from landing up into the end stage disease, landing up into stage 6, that is bronchiectasis or chronic pulmonary aspergillosis. And the treatment should have minimal or no adverse effects, and you should always try to identify and exclude any potential environmental source that may be responsible for ABPA. So now we have common drugs like glucocorticoids, which are available. Then we have antifungals, and we have anti-IgE and IL-5-4-5 like monoclonal antibody drugs, which are available. We'll just talk about it briefly in the next few minutes. So other treatment modalities may be nebulized amphotericin B, inhaled corticosteroids, and monoclonal antibodies, as I thought. So we know that the steroids are the first line treatment, but regarding the dosing and the schedule, there was a very good RCT that was published in 2016 that was done in PGI, which has compared the low dose steroid regimen with the medium to high dose, 0.5 milligram per kg per day to start with for 3 to 5 months in the tapering doses. And the other group had 0.75 milligram per kg that was tapered gradually for 6 to 12 months. The study showed that the exacerbation after 1 year and the glucocorticoid dependence after 2 years was similar in both the groups. So even the low dose corticosteroids are equally efficacious as medium to high dose, but obviously the side effects were higher in the high dose group. So low to medium dose oral glucocorticoids are as effective and safer alternative to high dose, as most of the general practitioners do give high dose, which is not at all recommended. And a lot of data has come up in its support that low dose are quite effective. Intravenous pulse steroids of glucocorticoids, there is not much evidence to support, except in refractory ABP exacerbation. There are few case series or case reports are there. Inhaled corticosteroids, they do not have any role in the management of ABPA upfront as a first-line therapy, but yes, as an add-on therapy for the control of symptoms of asthma, they should be used. Then antifungals, they reduce the antigenic response and decrease the need for glucocorticoids. They have shown to decrease the number of sputum eosinophils, decrease IgE levels, IgG levels, and decrease few exacerbations also. But the question is whether to start antifungals at the upfront. So there was a trial that was published in 2018, which compared itraconazole versus prednisolone in acute stage ABPA, that whether itraconazole should be given upfront in newly diagnosed patients or not. They showed that the composite response was 100% in the patients who were giving steroids, as compared to 88% who were given the antifungals. So steroids were superior to the antifungals. And the time to first exacerbations, number of patients experiencing the exacerbations, IgE levels, improvement in lung functions were similar. And the occurrence of adverse effects was also similar in both the groups. But the response was better. But one thing that has come up that in patients who are not tolerating steroids, who are having a lot of side effects with steroids, we have a lot of diabetes, hypertension patients in our OPDs. So in those patients, starting itraconazole upfront may be an alternative when you are not able to use prednisolone because of the side effects. So itraconazole may be an attractive alternative in the initial management of EPPA if you have side effects with steroids. Another important trial which has recently been published in 2022, which compared steroids along with the combination with the itraconazole. There were 191 subjects that were that received. One group received prednisolone alone and another received prednisolone with the antifungal. And they showed that though the one-year exacerbation rate was lower in the combination group, but it was not statistically different. And the mean time to first exacerbation was also similar. And the side effects, that is deranged LFTs, were more in the combination groups. So though there was trend towards decline in ABP exacerbations in the combination group, but it was not statistically significant and it had more side effects. So starting with the combination upfront, still there is not much data. More studies are needed. Till now, the data is still in favor of steroids to be started in upfront. But if the patient is having recurrent exacerbations, patient is having side effects, and not able to tolerate, then only itraconazole may be added, or itraconazole may be added as an upfront when you are not able to use steroid. And obviously there are other steroid, other antifungals also, like voriconazole and posiconazole. Voriconazole is not being used very commonly in place of itraconazole, and it has shown a very good efficacy in ABPA similar to that of itraconazole with a better safety profile. There has been few case reports in case series for nebulized amphotericin B with in ABPA patients. And though the number of exacerbations were less at 1 year, that were 8.3% as compared to 63%, but still a larger trials are needed to confirm, and this should be taken as a reserve drug when all other treatments have failed. Next, coming on to the monoclonal antibodies of, yes, omalizumab, and there are other drugs like mepolizumab, anti-IL-4, penralizumab, and dupilumab, which are there. There are a lot of case series which are coming up. Case reports are there, especially in patients of severe asthma with increased eosinophils in blood. They have a role, but still they are still lower down in the treatment. They are used as in only in those patients where the patient is not responding to steroids or antifungals. And we need more data for using them on upfront. Other adjunct therapies that may be used are the nebulized hypertonic saline for expectoration of the mucus. Therapeutic bronchoscopy do not have much role, but they may be used if there is collapse is there on HRCT and that is persisting even after steroid therapy. Pneumococcal and influenza vaccine is recommended as we do recommend in other chronic lung diseases. And lung transplant may be offered in patients who have ended up in the stage 6 and who have bronchiectasis and who have called pulmonary. If the patient has a life expectancy, we may offer them lung transplantation, but that is the last resort, obviously. So to summarize, when the patient comes to you with acute stage ABPA, you start the treatment with glucocorticoids at least 4 to 6 months. Follow them up with chest radiographs, spirometry, and IgE levels every 6 to 8 weeks. And assess the response by the IgE levels. If the fall is more than 25%, then you can say, and clinical and radiological improvement is there, you can say that patient is responding. When the patient is off steroid for 6 months, then you can label the patient as in stage 4, that is remission phase. But if the patient on treatment is having exacerbations, then if the patient was already on steroids, then you may add itraconazole to it. And still, if the patient, you are not able to taper down steroid, then you label the patient as treatment dependent, that is stage 5, and you need to demarcate whether this dependency is because of asthma or because of the ABPA by doing the radiology as well as the IgE levels. If the patient is already on steroids and itraconazole and still not responding, then the last resorts may be pulse methylprednisolone, nebulized amphotericin B or omalizumab. So this in a nutshell is the ABPA when you have to screen for the ABPA, when you have, there are definite criterias for the ABPA, and once you have diagnosed ABPA, you need to stage them in what stage the patient is, and then further offer the patient treatment. The radiology part will be discussed subsequently. So thank you.
Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank CCI and Dr. Krishna for having me here. And we will today be discussing about radiological findings of ABPA. I am Dr. Nikhil Gupta, and I am presently working in Fortis Mohali as a consultant radiologist. So coming to the utility of imaging, first is the chest X-ray. It is the primary investigation for screening, and it is used to look for consolidation, which may be patchy, peripheral, parahilar, segmental or lobar, and to look for abnormal bronchi or coexisting diseases such as COPD or chronic heart failure, and it is best for lobar involvement and pleural effusion. Next modality is CT, which is more sensitive than plain radiograph, and it is better in detecting airway abnormalities associated with ABPA. It is also used in cases where there is a high clinical suspicion but normal or questionable chest radiograph, or in cases where there is suspicion of underlying disease. Next modality is MRI, which is superior to non-contrast CT in evaluation of mediastinal masses, pleural abnormalities and presence of caseation. Diffusion restriction in lymph nodes is a marker for disease activity, and it is used for follow-up in young patients and alternative to CT in pregnant patients. Coming to the spectrum of Aspergillus infections, which is according to the immune status of the patient. In immunocompetent patients, there may be ABPA or aspergilloma. But in immunocompromised patients, generally we see chronic cavitary pulmonary aspergillosis or invasive aspergillosis. For diagnosis of ABPA, the criteria used can be remembered by acronym ASPER, which stands for asthma, specific serum antibodies like IgG and IgE for Aspergillus, proximal bronchiectasis, elevated IgE, which is greater than 100 nanogram per ml, and reactive skin test to Aspergillus antigen. Coming to the radiographic findings, it is divided into transient and permanent findings. The transient findings being perihilar infiltrate simulating adenopathy, air fluid levels from dilated central bronchi filled with fluid and debris, massive consolidation, unilateral or bilateral. Radiological infiltrates like toothpaste shadows due to mucoid impaction in damaged bronchi, gloved finger shadows from distally occluded bronchi filled with secretions, and tramline shadows representing edema of the bronchial walls. We can also find collapse, which may be lobar or segmental. This is a chest X-ray in a patient of ABPA, which is simulating carcinoma of the lung. It is showing atelectasis of basal segments of left lower lobe, and mucoid impaction here is simulating adenopathy. This was later resolved by steroid therapy. This is an X-ray showing central bronchiectasis with ring shadows in the parahilar regions and nodular opacity in the bilateral lungs, multiple nodular opacities. Coming to this X-ray, here is an X-ray of a patient showing right upper lobe consolidation with several areas of cavitation within. These are the areas of cavitation which further cleared on steroids. And in this, the patient presented only with this finding, that is segmental atelectasis of right upper lobe. This is a chest X-ray showing typical VY shadows like classic finger in glove appearance. It can be seen here, and these are N-phase bronchi, also mucoid due to mucoid impaction. The transient findings can be divided into common and uncommon findings, the common being patchy areas of consolidation, radiological infiltrates and collapse, and uncommon being bronchial wall thickening, air fluid levels from dilated bronchi filled with fluid, perihilar infiltrates, simulated adenopathy, massive consolidation, unilateral or bilateral, small nodules, and pleural effusions. Here is the chest X-ray showing allergic aspergillosis with right middle lobe obstruction, which progressed to pneumonia and cavitation. That also cleared following steroid therapy. Now, the permanent findings. On a chest radiograph, these are central bronchiectasis with normal peripheral bronchi, parallel line shadows representing bronchial widening, ring shadows 1 to 2 cm in diameter representing dilated bronchi and face, and pulmonary fibrosis. Also, the late changes, which are the complications, are cavitation, contracted upper lobes, and localized emphysema. This is a chest radiograph showing classic secular bronchiectasis, which is virtually pathognomic of ABPA. The permanent changes can also be divided into common and uncommon findings. The common findings being parallel line shadows representing bronchial widening, ring shadows 1 to 2 cm in diameter representing bronchial end phase, and pulmonary fibrosis, fibrotic scarred upper lobes with cavitation. Uncommon findings being pleural thickening, mycetoma formation, and linear scars. This is a classical study which was published in Radiology, which shows pseudohilar adenopathy, cavitation, mycetoma, empyema, and pneumothorax are the uncommon findings. This was a small study with 14 patients of ABPA. This is an uncommon finding of ABPA showing right-sided pneumothorax with underlying bronchiectasis in a patient with long-standing ABPA. And this is another patient with serial X-rays, the first one showing consolidation in the right upper lobe, and the second one progressed to mycetoma later on, for which sputum cultures were positive for Aspergillus fumigatus. Now coming to the HRCT findings. First of all, the bronchial findings on HRCT, which are bronchiectasis, which is usually central and is characterized by signet ring or string of pearls appearance. Dilated bronchi with or without air fluid levels, totally occluded bronchi, bronchial wall thickening, parallel line opacities extending to the periphery, and high attenuation mucus plugs. Coming to bronchiectasis, it is seen as a signet ring in this, like here shown in this CT, and we can calculate the B by A diameter, that is bronchioatrial diameter, which is equal to the ratio of inner diameter of the bronchus and outer diameter of the artery. So the normal ratio is 0.65 to 7, and can also, in some individuals, it can also be up to 1. And if it is more than 1.5, it is a sign of bronchiectasis. It gives a signet ring pattern as seen here. Coming to another CT showing mucus plugging and bilateral central bronchiectasis. This is another CT showing classical varicoid bronchiectasis and some patchy consolidations and some treen bud nodules like seen here, and mucus impaction as seen here. These are high attenuation mucus plugs with HU more than 100. Then coming to the parenchymal findings, which are consolidation, non-homogeneous patchy opacities, parenchymal scarring of varying extent, segmental or lobar collapse, cavitation, and emphysematous bulle. This is a CT showing some ground glass opacity in left upper lobe, and some bronchiectasis which is reaching up to the periphery, and centrilobular opacities which are seen as treen bud as seen here, and some are seen here. Coming to the pleural findings on HRCT, these are pleural effusions, spontaneous pneumothorax, bronchopleural fistula, pleural fibrosis, and pleural thickening. Here is a CT showing bilateral pleural effusion in a known case of ABPA that came with complications later on. This is the CT of the same patient showing bronchiectasis in right upper lobe and central bronchiectasis bilaterally. Also, there are some air fluid levels in the upper bronchi, and there are some tree invert nodules as seen here, and areas of patchy consolidation in bilateral basal lobes as seen here, and pleural effusion which was seen in the earlier slide. Coming to the common and the uncommon findings on HRCT. The common findings being central bronchiectasis, mucus plugging with bronchoceles, consolidation, central lobular nodules with reinvert opacities, bronchial wall thickening, areas of atelectasis, mosaic perfusion with air trapping on expiration. And uncommon being high attenuation mucus, which is a most helpful finding in differential diagnosis. It is seen in around 20% cases. Pleural involvement is very rare. It is generally seen in later or complicated cases, and randomly scattered nodular opacities. About these, we generally see tree invert opacities, but random opacities are generally rare. Coming to the differential diagnosis of the ABPA. As such, there are very less differential diagnosis, but differential diagnosis of central bronchiectasis can be congenital tracheobronchomegaly, also known as Mounier-Kuhn syndrome, cystic fibrosis, and Williams-Campbell syndrome, which is rare. And for mucoid impaction, we should consider the following differentials, like mucoid impaction secondary to bronchiectasis due to any cause, secondary to endobronchial lesion, and secondary to atretic bronchial segment. Now, let us discuss some cases which came to our department. This is all these cases were proven to be ABPA. Coming to the first case, this is an X-ray of a 67-year-old male showing overinflated bilateral lung fields, multiple peripheral nodules, and some showing cavitation like here. We gave this as ABPA with secondary infection. This is a second case showing a 61-year-old male patient, and we can see mucus impaction and some ring shadows in bilateral hilar regions. On CT, we can see some tubular and varicoid bronchiectasis and a patch of GGOs, ill-defined GGOs, and adjacent tiny central lobular nodules, which were also seen in this. And in this same patient, we also came across high attenuation mucus plugs. Then coming to this another case of a 70-year-old female, in which scanogram clearly shows mucus plugging bilaterally and multiple ring shadows in the bilateral hilar and perihilar region. So coming to the CT of this patient, we could see multiple bronchiectatic changes, like we can see it here, and in this next CT, there are also these bronchiectatic changes. There is mucus impaction, which is seen here, and some which was giving VY pattern, and also subtle ground glass opacities also seen here. And this is all in this patient. Coming to our next case, it was a case of a 35-year-old female. The chest X-ray PA view shows multiple nodular opacities and subtle hilar shadows representing bronchial mucus impaction. In this CT, we can also see additionally an area of consolidation in the left upper lobe with and there is a central predominance of bronchiectasis. Also, there is mucus plugging. Here we can see some mucus plugging, and some centrilobular nodules, which we can see in here and here. Coming to our last case, this is a scanogram of a 71-year-old male showing multiple ring shadows and some ill-defined opacities in the right, in the bilateral upper lobes. On CT, we can see classic varicoid bronchiectasis bilaterally, and also we can see an area of fibrosis, which is a late change. And here also we can see fibrosis, some GGOs and some centrilobular nodules. Now, to summarize our ABPA, it is a hypersensitivity reaction to Aspergillus. There is history of asthma, atopy and cystic fibrosis. Type 1 is IgE mediated hypersensitivity resulting in wheezing. Type 3 is IgG mediated antigen antibody complex reaction resulting in bronchiectasis. The radiographic findings being consolidation, that is eosinophilic pneumonia, central bronchiectasis, upper lobe or widespread, mucus plugging, finger in glove appearance, increased lung volume and upper lobe volume loss or scarring. The HRCT findings being the central bronchiectasis, which may be widespread, upper lobe predominance common, though lower lobes can also be involved, mucus plugging, mucus plugs appear high density, tree in bud, nodules, atelectasis, peripheral consolidation or diffuse ground glass opacity, mosaic perfusion and air trapping on expiration. Thank you all.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you, CCI, for giving me an opportunity to moderate this excellent panel discussion and excellent panelists that I have. Thanks, Ravi Dosi, for giving a very good introduction, and followed by Shweta Bansal for taking us through the clinical features, diagnosis, criteria for diagnosing ABPA and treatment. Nikhil, wonderful job exhaustively mentioning about all the features of the radiological features of the ABPA and some rare cases, and also your own personal presentation. So we have an excellent panel discussion today, and we have excellent panelists today to discuss about various clinical features, diagnosis, treatment, and what that we see on a regular basis in our clinical practice. Ravi, just to start the discussion, you started by saying it's a ubiquitous organism present in the air, present in the soil, and all of us inhale, and those who have a kind of lack of immunity, or those who have pre-existing lung disease, are prone for developing ABPA. All of us inhale, but these are all exhaled. Beautifully shown in your diagrams and your slides, showing that not everyone develops ABPA. Is that true? And why do you think some patients are prone for ABPA, and as you rightly mentioned that it is only a colonizing fungus in the tracheobronchial tree. It's not an invasive one, but causes very severe immunological reaction, both humoral and cell-mediated immunity. Ravi, your take on this? What do you think? Some patients are prone for it?
Sir, definitely immunity and immune response is determined genetically. That is what is postulated in several case studies. That is why some people develop ABPA, many people don't develop ABPA. Definitely family history has also been seen in ABPA. And an exaggerated hypersensitivity response varies person to person, sir. That is why ABPA is not universally seen, because like ABPA is present practically everywhere. Day in, day out, we get exposed to these spores. But like Shweta ma'am told, I think hardly 7 to 9% is what she had quoted. They might go on to develop ABPA eventually. So I think there is a strong genetic component which is proposed to this varying nature of immunity, sir.
Yes, yes, yes. I think so, because if there is a genetic predisposition and some local factors which are involved in seeing that the spores of the fungi stays inside the tracheal bronchial tree, and then there is a exaggerated immunological reaction which causes patients symptoms and development of ABPA. Okay, that's a good one, Ravi. Shweta, you mentioned about the prevalence rate, and you showed nicely about the studies which have, I think in the asthma clinics, the naturally we pick up more than the general clinics. And you also showed that I think there are nearly 190 million asthmatics, and in that 5 million of them could be having ABPA.
Worldwide, yes.
Yeah, it is quite high, isn't it? And many of us sometimes don't screen them and don't even think about it. And the longer we take to diagnose them, and they develop complications, they come in with bronchiectasis, scarring, fibrosis, and then it's too late for us. It's very easy to diagnose. And Nikhil will easily say in 1 minute that, you know, this is ABPA. And Shweta, what do you think about it, that we should be screening all patients, we should be screening highly suspected patients, which you gave the criteria? What do you think is your take on screening of these patients for ABPA, because the numbers are huge?
Yes sir, considering the burden of ABPA in asthma, my take would be to have a high index of suspicion in every patient of asthma. Especially whenever the patient comes to you for the first time and have the, like I told in the presentation also, the patient is not getting controlled, especially the uncontrolled asthma we are having. But even in controlled asthma, patient is coming to the first time, then we should screen for ABP in all asthma patients, newly diagnosed asthma patients.
Okay. So I think, you know, what you're trying to say is have a high index of suspicion,
yes, sir.
And in all patients with asthma, especially those you mentioned, that those who are uncontrolled, requiring high medications, like high dose of inhaled corticosteroids, or who come with exacerbation, and whose IgE levels are high, eosinophils are high, you know.
Various pointers, yes, sir.
Yeah, when I was going through this, you know, literature about it, and I came across, I frankly didn't know that there is World Aspergillus Day, which happens to be on 1st of February, which tells us the importance of this fungus, the Aspergillus, whether it is an invasive fungus in those who have low immunity due to organ transplant or steroids or HIV and AIDS, or an exaggerated immune response like what we are discussing about ABPA. So we must screen these patients for. What about your clinic, Shweta? What do you think that do you see? What percentage of patients do you see them high? And others can also chip in and say, and go on with you.
Yes, sir. ABPA is quite common. I do screen with the total specific IgE and especially total IgE for these patients. And if eosinophilia is there, we do screen, and it's quite common. I would not say exactly, maybe 9 to 10% of the asthma patients do eventually are diagnosed as ABPA, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think most of us miss, I think, you know, if you yes. see the Dr. Ritesh.
Most of them are already on treatment, already on steroids for many years. So that also leads to delay in the diagnosis.
And then they don't come for follow-up and we, yes, you know, they go to different doctors and we miss an opportunity. If, for example, not getting better, we would have definitely screened them. Ravi, what do you think in your clinic that you have ABPA incidences? Is it common, like Shweta was saying, 9 to 10%?
Well, I wouldn't say so common, sir. But it's there. But in my proportion of patients, I hardly see it in maybe, you know, 4 or 5 out of 100 patients that I treat. So not very commonly that I see it.
Okay. Abhay, what about you?
Yeah, basically, what I routinely do on all asthmatic patients when they come in the OPD, those with especially moderate to severe persistent asthma, get a skin prick test done.
Yeah,
that is a common thing we can, especially for Aspergillus. And most of this patient, about say around 40 to 50% might be having a skin prick test positive. So if you don't, the patient can't spend for the lab specific Aspergillus IgE, then you can just do a skin prick test. At least in this patient, we can definitely suspect ABPA. Especially in Mumbai, we have got a lot of humid atmosphere. There is a lot of leakage occurring because of all the rainy season. And some of the places, those who are staying around the dumping ground, like D.Y. Patil is nearby to a dumping ground in Govindi. So these patients are exposed to various kind of decaying material, decaying vegetations. So when these people are coming from that particular area, so we should always suspect Aspergillus sensitivity. We are not saying that it could be an ABPA full blown, but you can always rule out Aspergillus sensitivity in this patient. Doing a routine skin prick test in OPD, we can do it. And if it is coming significantly positive, then you can send an Aspergillus specific IgE and then work up for ABPA.
Okay. So I think it's a good point to do some simple tests which are not so expensive. And if we start phenotyping all our asthmatic by doing an eosinophil count and then IgE, all patients, and then we may have a patient who throws up with a very high IgE. I had a patient just today who was being investigated for idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, and IgE was very high, something like 4,500, I remember, because just today I saw, and I asked for a specific Aspergillus IgE, which was also high, but asymptomatic. And he had some skin problem. He says, is it connected with my skin fungal infection that I have? So like this, there may be an asymptomatic patient. There can be patients who come with symptoms. So let's move on. Very interesting. It's getting to Shweta. Any clinical features that makes you, you know, think that this could be ABPA, and let me, you know, go on investigating about this patient, because the repercussions can be very severe if you don't miss them in the beginning. Any thoughts on that?
Yes, sir. Like, as if a patient, the most important thing is if the patient has been already diagnosed as asthma and still he is not getting controlled, the symptoms like cough, breathlessness and wheezing is still there, even being compliant to the treatment, even being on regular inhalers, this is a thing that we should always suspect. But if we specifically look into the historical part, the recurrent wheezing is there. If the patient is having brownish, the expectoration of brownish or black blood plugs in the sputum, or if the patient is hemoptysis, which is itself an indicator for bronchiectasis. So, and bronchiectasis in an asthma patient, when there is, then you should always look, start your screening for ABPA. Or if there is a constitutional symptoms, but even on repeated investigations, the tuberculosis is not getting diagnosed. Patient has fever, loss of weight, fever. These are very commonly presentations of ABPA and commonly misdiagnosed as tuberculosis. So these are the clinical features you should look for. And then on examination, like when the patient is having asthma for so long, but still on an asthma patient who has been controlled in between, but still having features of pulmonary hypertension, having type 1 respiratory failure, having clubbing, which is suggestive of, again, bronchiectasis. And so these are the patients you should screen for ABPA.
Absolutely. I agree with you. And especially when a patient with asthma comes and says that you know, I have hemoptysis. You don't expect in a regular patient of
asthma patient, yes.
The garden variety of asthma, they don't have, unless they have some infection. But when they start saying that I have recurrent hemoptysis, and when you screen them, you may pick up. Ravi, you have any clinical pearls on picking up early?
Sir, patients who have an escalating requirement of steroids, basically, with no significant fever complaints, they just keep on wanting more and more and getting poor and poor relief from your old prescription. In them, it is very common to find this, sir, basically. And I have also seen patients who have very frequent exacerbations, means they are commonly those asthmatics whom we should strongly suspect for ABPA, apart from all that Shweta ma'am has told.
I think absolutely right. If you feel that patient who is compliant and adherent to the treatment and who comes with exacerbations frequently are not controlled on regular treatment, I think that's when you should suspect and then do this simple test. So I feel all patients of asthma must have a chest X-ray, and sometimes Nikhil will call in and tell us, you know, look, there is something unusual in this X-ray and what is the clinical history? And he may pick up some very subtle central bronchiectasis, or he may say that, oh, there is very classical central bronchiectasis and so on. And if the eosinophil count is more than 500, and if the IgE levels are high, in my patient, which was about 4,000, and patient had absolutely no symptoms except some skin symptoms. So let's move on. And coming back to you, Shweta, so diagnostic criteria, you showed us all the guidelines and then the diagnostic criteria, Rosenberg, Peterson criteria, then Isham diagnostic criteria, and major criteria and minor criteria. I think we should apply them because they really give us an insight into the diagnosis of ABPA and tell us that this particular patient may be definitely having an ABPA. So what test would you, if you are strongly suspecting in your clinic, in your patient, so what test would you like to do further? You've done an eosinophil count, you've done an Ig specific, the regular IgE, total IgE. What other tests will throw a light? Abhay already mentioned about the skin prick test, and you also showed slides about it's something close to 90% sensitivity. Go on.
Yes, sir. We'll go on further with the specific IgE against Aspergillus, specific IgG against Aspergillus, and then with the radiology. These are the tests, apart from the total IgE and the eosinophils and the predisposing conditions of asthma, COPD, cystic fibrosis, and post-TB. If these are the tests are done, then we can confidently rule out, like we can, on the basis of Isham, we can diagnose whether they fulfill the criteria for ABPA or not. So these are the basic tests, starting with the eosinophil levels, total Ig, specific IgE, or skin prick test. Skin prick test, as I told in the recent Isham guidelines, they have not included because the sensitivity is a little bit less than the specific IgE. Then specific IgG against Aspergillus, serum precipitin still has less sensitivity, so they have also been removed. Then the next is the radiology. So these are the basics tests. Yes, sir. Okay. All patients should be.
Yes. And Nikhil, have you had any patient whom you want your clinician, you know, look, this patient looks like an ABPA, and are you suspecting ABPA in an unsuspected patient? Patient routinely goes to an X-ray, and then you call your friend, colleague, and saying that, look, this looks like an ABPA. I'm sure you would have had in your experience, Nikhil.
Yes, sir. There are patients like that.
Yeah.
Frequently.
Okay. So What radiological feature that you strongly suspect that this could be an ABPA and warn the clinician, look, can you do something more in this patient to diagnose ABPA? What makes you really think about ABPA? What radiological diagnostic criteria?
like common diagnostic findings are generally patchy consolidation, rates, collapse, or like permanent changes like parallel line shadows, ring shadows, or maybe fibrosis also.
And fleeting shadows, isn't it? Sometimes you see if you have X-rays, if you have, look, there was something in this X-ray and then it disappeared and then the clinician can look into it. Okay. So, thank you. Abhay, differential diagnosis. In India, everything is tuberculosis unless otherwise proved. And I was going through Dr. Prasad, who also has a lot of interest in ABPA. And he was saying in his practice of 20 years or so, and his interest in ABPA, 90% of patients with ABPA are on anti-TB treatment, even though there was no AFP positive or a gene expert positive. So I think all of us see that. What is your take, Abhay?
Yeah, no, basically, the first thing during my residency, I missed one ABPA.
Yeah.
So this patient typically came with the presentation of fever, weight loss, cough, and he had significant level weight loss of 10 kg something. And the X-ray was showing that infiltrates in the pec zone, and that time we didn't know about ABPA much. I diagnosed it as ABPA later on, but first thing it was diagnosed as tuberculosis. And that time we didn't have the gene expert. When we used to do a smear examination, the patient was not able to induce sputum. So this patient was empirically put on AKT. And when the patient came for follow-up over a period after, say that time used to come after 3 weeks or 4 weeks, then the patient was found to be having a different X-ray pattern. The infiltrates was seen in the, previously it came with left side infiltrates. Now the patient had the infiltrates on the left side had disappeared completely and it has appeared on the right side. So at that time we suspected that it could be something else. And that time we didn't have that typical ABPA panel. So that even the Ranbaxy came with the typical pattern panel later on. So that was the first thing we missed out. The patient, we did the routine CBC, it was found to be having a eustophilia. So this is a common thing that most of the time in India we missed, especially if the patient is having asthma history, then we have to always first suspect ABPA rather than suspect tuberculosis, especially if they're having fleeting pulmonary infiltrates or if the patient is having higher eosinophilia. So you can always suspect ABPA in this patient rather than suspecting tuberculosis.
Yes, yes. I'm sure. I mean, Shweta also showed in her presentation that symptoms like fever, malaise, and other features in an asthmatic patient can be a feature of ABPA, like fever and so on. Many a time, we don't think that this is not an infection, a fungal infection, so they may not get fever. But as she said, I showed in the slide that fever, malaise can be a presentation. So the differential diagnosis would be anything like a bronchiectasis, not due to ABPA. And of course, in Western countries, cystic fibrosis. I've seen myself in UK, a lot of cystic fibrosis patients suspected and having ABPA. And the combination is dreadful to treat them. And they come for antibiotics every now and then. And they're very sick. They are malnourished. And of course, it so much has improved. And many a time they would come for total parental nutrition as an outpatient. So it's a dreadful combination of cystic fibrosis and ABPA. And many seen programs on BBC showing about cystic fibrosis and a combination of ABPA. So we finished about the diagnosis, and sometimes when we see shadows, we also do bronchoscopy. Shweta, what do you think is the role of bronchoscopy here? Because when you see something more and not a clear-cut X-ray, you would like to see and know what exactly is going on inside. So what do you think bronchoscopy in ABPA?
Sir, bronchoscopy does not have a per se very primarily primary role in the for the diagnosis, but it has a supportive role in the sense that it will help to rule out other infections like tuberculosis, or if the patient has presented with pulmonary eosinophilia or more of blood eosinophil counts. So you may do bronchoscopy and bowel and see for any eosinophils in the bowel, and you can take the samples for ruling out other microbiological infections. And the second thing is for the therapeutic purpose, if the patient has collapse as a presentation of ABPA, and even after steroid therapy it is not getting clear, then you can do bronchial toileting for the better response and clearing of the collapse.
Absolutely. I remember long time back, maybe about 15, 20 years back, one of my patients used to come every time, come with a very severe breathlessness, and then had always had a very severe lung collapse, either right upper lobe or lower lobe. And second time onwards, she only used to ask us, can you do a bronchoscopy and take out all this? I felt so good after the after doing a bronchoscopy. And then she had very severe asthma. I was really scared to do bronchoscopy on this patient. But you can get, and sometimes you can do a therapeutic bronchoscopy in there, in these patients. Okay, let's move on with the treatment aspect. So we have done with the prevalence, we have done with the diagnosis and diagnostic criteria, and Nikhil mentioned about the radiological features and when to suspect. Shweta, you summarized very well that there are two types of treatment, and the others are not very commonly used. The one to reduce the inflammation, and also I think in a way it prevents progression of the disease. The aim or the goals of treatment is, number one, to reduce the inflammation caused by Aspergillus spores, fungus, and then also to prevent progression of the disease. You mentioned about the steroids, and you gave also some guidelines, and also mentioned about Dr. Ritesh Agarwal's paper showing us about the various regimes that we have. You mentioned about the high dose, the low dose, and the medium dose. So what do you use in your practice? What do you think we must use, and what do you use in your practice about the steroids in ABPA?
Sir, in the newly diagnosed ABPA patients, I start with steroids as a first-line treatment. And if the patient is having recurrent exacerbations, or if the patient is having side effects, then only we can shift over to the antifungals. Or if the patient is having recurrent exacerbations, then we may add upon antifungals with steroids. But first line, my preference is always to start with steroids and not with the combination or antifungals alone.
Yeah, I think you showed in your slide that the combination upfront may not be a good idea, but there may be a patient, as you mentioned, that who has probably very high diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes, or some other complication, and where steroid use on a long term may be a problem. And of course, we have, of course, patients' phobia for steroids. And when you start mentioning about steroids, and as you know how they come back at you, and then saying that the steroids have side effects and so on. Abhay, your take on steroid regime? 0.5 milligram, 0.75 milligram, also discuss about some, steroids which are there. Yeah.
As Dr. Shweta has mentioned, the 0.5 milligram dose is also much effective as compared to 0.75. Now, only thing is, ideally, we can, when the which stage the patient is coming, whether the patient is in the acute phase or exacerbation phase, whether it's a newly diagnosed ABPA, or it is the first time the patient has been diagnosed with ABPA. According to that, we can plan the steroid regimes. So we can start with 0.5 milligram per kg body weight for a period of 2 weeks. And later on, after 2 weeks, we can give a 0.5 milligram per kg body weight alternate day for another period of 8 weeks and see the response of the patient. If the patient is clinically improving, then we can taper the steroids further by reducing every weekly, we can reduce the dose by 5 milligram per kg. Now, it all depends on the patient's response, and I think it varies from person to person, patient to patient. Some patient will respond dramatically after giving steroids. Some patient may not respond, and they may be in the exacerbation phase or in the stage 5 phase where they are steroid dependent. So it all depends on which stage the patient is coming to you. And the triggering factors needs to be identified first when the patient comes to your OPD. Because if the patient is exposed to that particular environment continuously, the patient is not going to respond to any kind of treatment. So that way we are giving the high dose of steroids to the patient without identifying the triggering factor. So if the triggering factor is at the home, if the triggering factor is in the office or surrounding environment, that needs to be identified and the patient should be isolated from the environment. Then only we can plan the minimum dose of steroid will be more effective. It will be playing a role. If doesn't respond to that any kind of steroid, even after giving a period of over a period of 6 months, then we can plan on to add on antifungals in this patient. So starting with just anti-inflammatory steroid, we can start. And as I said, which stage the patient is, if it is already in stage 5, then we have to give a combination of oral steroid with antifungals in this patient.
Okay. So let me summarize this for everyone, what Shweta and Abhay were saying, especially for the viewers and youngsters who are watching this webinar. Why we are discussing this, why it's important that the steroid dosage and the regimen, and why for 2 weeks, 0.5 or 0.75, which you may choose, is important. Because if you choose to give the right dose of steroids in the beginning, then you will prevent complication, the dreaded complication, what we have all seen, what Nikhil showed, several X-rays and CT scan features, which are very scary, the fibrosis, the bronchiectasis, the scarring, the respiratory failure, and Shweta was mentioning clubbing, respiratory failure, and even mentioned in the end about lung transplant. So all this can be prevented if you convince the patient, spend some time with the patient, counsel the patient why steroids are so important here and why it is the drug of choice and why we may not get an opportunity again to give the high dose of steroids or medium dose of steroids when they come with the late stages of fibrosis and bronchiectasis. So that's why it's important that we choose the right steroid, give the proper regimen, and also give it longer. What you mentioned about each patient you assess periodically, tell them to come back 3 months maybe, and then 4 to 6 months, and then stop the treatment depending on the patient. And of course, follow up for complications of steroid side effects and warn the patient about the blood sugar, the obesity, the high blood pressure, osteonecrosis, osteoporosis, gastric bleeding, and so on. But they are so useful that we must give them the right dose of steroids. And then follow up regularly. And then especially young patient, I've had a young patient where it's very difficult to convince them about taking for a longer period. Somehow they'll keep pushing themselves. No, I'm fine. I'm all right. I don't think I should be taking steroids and so on. But it's important to stress upon them the complications of not giving steroids in the beginning. And of course, Ravi was mentioning about the acute exacerbation. When they come with acute exacerbation, of course, in a patient with ABPA, the steroids are life-saving and they are the main drugs that we should use. And the next treatment that we all discussed and Shweta showed was the antifungal treatment, which has come, I think, in the last 10 years or so about the role of antifungal. Even though it's not an invasive fungus, but you can find hyphae, you can find spores, you can find these organisms, which are the fungus, which is there. So that is why I think the antifungals have a role. Shweta mentioned in her slides, there are two antifungals, and there can be the third one, which is posaconazole. The one is the itraconazole that we are all used to, and then the voriconazole, and sometimes posaconazole, and also Shweta mentioned about the role of amphotericin in few patients, especially the inhaled form or the nebulized form of amphotericin. So, Shweta, your take on antifungals, you already mentioned that you won't start the patient upfront with a steroid, but you also mentioned that patient who is not able to tolerate, who comes with repeated exacerbation. Go ahead about it.
Yes, sir. Only if the patient is not able to, the patient upfront refuses that I will not take steroids, or we know that patient is already having uncontrolled diabetes, uncontrolled hypertension, and we expect that the patient will not be able to tolerate steroids, their itraconazole or voriconazole may be started upfront, and we may follow the patient clinical, radiological, and with IG levels. The studies have also shown, the study I showed, the prednisolone versus itraconazole, the itraconazole had 88% composite response. So it is not so bad also. It's almost... Yeah. Compared to 100% in the steroid group. So it's a good alternative in the patients in whom we are suspecting side effects or patients refuses upfront.
Okay. So your choice is itraconazole, like all of us, we are very familiar.
Voriconazole also we have started giving.
Also, yes. Isn't it? Late. And the duration of treatment?
So minimum 4 to 4 months, but maybe prolonged to 6 months also.
On 6 months, isn't it? Ravi, your take on this antifungals?
Sir, itraconazole is more practical patients afford it basically. So they are able to take it for 4 to 6 months. Voriconazole is much better. Posaconazole might be the best, but I feel practically in a clinic OPD practice, itraconazole is what rules.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And of course we have to watch for the side effects, innumerable drug interaction that especially itraconazole. And I will give you one tip of using itraconazole. I learned it from Ritesh. I had a difficult patient. I was discussing with him. And he said, which brand are you using? Itraconazole. So I said, a particular brand. Then he said, use this one. And
which one, sir?
Which is the original one, the Sporonac. I think the company which makes is, I think, I can't remember offhand. And he said, oh, yes, I've used this 20 years back. They were the first one to introduce. He said, there are many companies which have introduced, but use this one. And his main thing is about the biological levels that it attains in the blood with this molecule and with this particular company, which is an original molecule. So he said, try this itraconazole of this combination and use, especially before food, and the absorption is much better, or with the food, as they are
with the food, yes. Food,
with the food, then the absorption is much better, the effectiveness also is superior. So this is about antifungals.
I would like to add, sir, the voriconazole should be taken empty stomach, either 1 hour before or 2 hours after the meals.
Okay. And of course, there are so many side effects of the drug interactions. Abhay, do you want to mention any important drug interaction? Of course, there is app which is there. And you want to say anything about the drug interaction? Yeah. Important one for the viewers.
Yeah, basically, if it is the patient is taking a steroid with itraconazole antifungal for a long period of time, then definitely it causes adrenal cushingoid features. Patient will be having adrenal suppressions because of the release of the suppression of cytochrome P450 enzymes. So that leads to increased bioavailability and causes adrenal suppressions in these patients over a period of long time.
Okay. So, yes, I mean, also the other...
One more, sir.
Yes, Ravi.
Oral hypoglycemic agents, sir, with itraconazole, oral hypoglycemic agents have to be titrated, their dose have to be modified very importantly.
And voriconazole not to be given with ATT.
Yes, I mean, so when you have a patient on this combination, you should really look into the app, which is available for the drug interactions. And like how patients on antiretroviral drugs, we always look at the drug interactions that they may have. So one has to be careful about these drug interactions, and also methylprednisolone. You know, don't use methylprednisolone. Use prednisolone, the visolone that we use, and then the omnocartyl, and these are good effect on this. Okay, so we have finished about the antifungal. We've finished about the steroids. Now biologicals, which are the new kits on the block, and all of us have used these. And then Shweta, you showed that the omalizumab is number one, mepolizumab you showed, benralizumab you showed. Also you mentioned about the other which are available, which are tongue twisters, difficult to even pronounce because they're not available. So I'm waiting for them to come, then I'll learn how to pronounce them, the Dupli, the Leuco, and so on. You have any experience? One by one can come out with biologicals. I will tell you my experience.
Sir, I have not used any biological in ABPA patient yet.
Okay. Abhay?
Yeah, basically biologics we can use, as I said, in stage 5 when we have given oral corticosteroids plus antifungals, and the patient is still having the persistent symptoms, all the IG para is still on the higher side. So in stage 5, when you have given everything, especially methylprednisolone, also in one patient we had given pulse dose of 1 gram for 3 days, and this patient was still having the symptoms. So yeah, in this patient, we have empirically, as Dr. Ritesh has given in most of his articles, to give empirical a fixed dose of 375 milligram after every 2 weeks, that is 750 milligram per month for a period of 4 months. So only one patient we had used, but we found not to be much effective in this patient, but symptomatically a little improvement was there in this patient. So we biologics only in omalizumab we have tried, but there are various trials that shows that after giving a dose of a fixed dose without exactly calculating the weight band and IG levels, you can give an empirical dose of 375 milligram after every 2 weeks and 750 milligram every 1 month for a period of 4 months. Then the patient's IG level shows significantly drop after some time. The patient shows clinical improvement in this patient. And there have been trials on mepolizumab also, but we have not used. Means they have given mepolizumab in 100 milligram once a month for a period of 4 months, and found to have a decrease in the eosinophil count and IG levels also. But personal experience, not seen much improvement with biologics in this patient.
Okay. Ravi, your take on this biologicals, your experience?
Sir, when we plot the weight and IG thing for calculating the IG dose, in ABPA, usually it crosses the limits only. So it goes out of the recommended dosage. So like sir told, 375 milligram that twice the regimen for 2 weeks, I think that is one thing which can be tried. But if you look at the proper dosing format, then it doesn't fall into anything. The omalizumab one, I had two patients who had come, they were under treatment from Chennai basically, and they I observed them for a little period of time, and they were doing well, sir. I saw them that their steroid requirements were very low when they were on omalizumab treatment.
Okay, yeah. So I my experience is I've used these are all off label, and there are case reports as Shweta showed in our slides, and definitely recommended if you see ABPA biologicals are mentioned. And off-label, of course. And omalizumab I have used on a couple of patients, and when omalizumab was only available. And the problem was, like Ravi mentioned, about the dosing. It goes out of the, because the IgE can be 4,000, 5,000, and then you have to use several doses, injections twice monthly, and it can be sometimes taxing. In one patient, I must remember here, and he's still on treatment, and he had very difficult ABPA. Also, he's 75, 78, well-known person, in Bangalore, and has a prostatic CA, has diabetes, has asthma, ABPA for a long period of time. And because he was not able to take steroids, side effects, sugars going up, prostatic cancer, and the other consultants say, so I used omalizumab for a year, not much improvement. Then this discussion came up also with another consultant friend of mine who is also known to him from US. And then we used mepolizumab for a year. And he said in between, he felt good, he felt better, but his still IgE was high and his eosinophil also was very consistently high. Didn't come down even with mepolizumab, maybe came down a little bit. And then I said, you know, let me try benralizumab. He was for anything because he was suffering so much. And then he was scared about the side effects of steroids. So he's on the third dose, I think, benralizumab now. And his eosinophil count is zero, which he sent just 2 days back. So it knocked off his eosinophils completely. As you know, Benrali does completely knocking off than compared to mepolizumab, advantages, disadvantages, which are there. So in a difficult patient, in a patient whose steroid doses is going up, in a patient who has problems, so one can try these biologicals, which are used in these patients. Of course, these are expensive. This comes with expense. And also, there is no course. If they respond well, you continue to give them because there is nothing like 1 year course, 2 year course, and things like that. So we are almost coming to end of these questions that we have. We also have questions from there. Also, adjuvant therapy. Shweta, you mentioned, which is also important, no role for inhaled corticosteroids in pure ABPA, not with asthma ABPA. Mucolytics, yes and no. Some patients, you know, you can use these mucolytics and so on and so forth. Let me take up, I can see some lot of questions here, lot of questions which have come up from the viewers here. When long-standing poorly controlled asthmatics already on steroids or suspected diagnosed ABPA, what should be the change in the management of patient and clinical response? I think we have partly answered this question from Kathmandu. City of Kathmandu says state Uttar Pradesh. Anyway, here is a difficult patient, poorly controlled with asthma. So naturally, you try everything that's possible. ABPA, so as all of us discussed here, use combination of steroids, give a course of a long period of steroids, not a short of 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks. Sometimes I've seen patients receiving just 2 weeks, 4 weeks, and that too half-hearted dose, not going to do any good to the patient. Maybe good psychologically for the patient and for the doctor, and but not for the patient. So use itraconazole, use oriconazole in this patient, doctor. And then if still not controlled, patient can afford, you can try a biological. There's a question in from Maharashtra, resource limiting practice. Can we do just CBC and normal eosinophil count to help us stop going further for costly work? Absolutely right. I think we mentioned not to diagnose ABPA because you have patient phenotype where the eosinophil is high and then the IgE is also high. They can have allergic rhinitis, they can have eczema, they are high. But when do you pick up an ABPA? When you suspect and do a specific test for this. And if cost is a problem, I think Abhay was mentioning about, even though it's not great, the skin prick test one can use even though it is not mentioned. So that is our answer, our panel answer for this question. Okay, I think that's Srivatsav. Okay, duration of systemic corticosteroid can minimum required dose criteria versus antibody titer or clinical signs. I think we answered this duration. I think Abhay mentioned and Shweta mentioned. Duration is minimum 3 months and then to 6 months. Please extend depending on the patient response to the therapy. Don't give less duration, less doses for these patients, because they may come asking for more in the future, but it may not be useful. This is a question from Maharashtra. Then should we use both antifungal plus corticosteroid as starting therapy? I think it was answered very well twice. By upfront starting these medications definitely more problem because of the drug interaction and so on, and don't use them when you have a patient upfront. But you can, in a patient, as Shweta is showing, that 88% response with only antifungal in a patient who does not want to take steroid, who has severe contraindication, not relative contraindication, a contraindication like probably an active gastric bleeding and so on, then you can use. Treatment plan for diabetes, I think I mentioned about it. Monitor sugars carefully in all these patients and warn them that that they should consult a proper diabetes specialist who will give a plan for them to monitor their sugar and then take care of it, because these are drugs of choice. This will be done. How common it is in COPD cases? Shweta, how common is it?
Exact prevalence is not known. There has been few case series and reports, but it is now been commonly seen. It is more because we are more now screening for ABPA, especially since the Isham criteria have come. Now we are looking for ABPA in COPD, and it is coming in case reports and series, but exact prevalence has not been mentioned.
So we have to keep a guard on it and then look in COPD.
There is one article by Dr. Ditesh where he has done a study, reported 250 patients were
aspergillus sensitization.
Has been researched, and it was found that it was AH sensitivity or hypersensitivity was seen in 8.5% of the COPD, while ABPA only 1% was documented in the COPD patient.
Okay. So also there's a question by Dr. Mittal from Haryana saying, how do you manage and follow up this patient with ABPA? I think it's a good question. How do we, once we have given the treatment, how do we follow up these patients? Abhay, how do you follow up your patient? You ask them to come frequently, how often, what test do you do? That's what this doctor wants to know.
Yeah, so basically once we label it as the patient of ABPA, then we should at least call him after 6 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks, and then monitor his X-ray parameters specifically, and how the clinically patient is improving, whether the patient is clinically showing improvement. We can do a routine X-ray and see if there is an X-ray showing any kind of fresh changes, and then monitor the IG levels. Now, IG levels, there should be an improvement in the IG percentage. Total IG should drop below 25% to 35% to label it as in the remission phase. Now, it all depends on the baseline IG level of the patient. Some patients' IG level may not drop completely, but 25 to 35% drop in IG level will definitely show that the patient is responding to the treatment. And later on, we can always taper. That is no fixed criteria that the patient should be given only 6 months treatment of steroid if the patient is clinically improving. And then we can taper the steroid before also. So it depends how the patient's IG shows a decline and whether the patient is going into remission phase. As per that, we can monitor the patients.
Okay. So thank you. There is a question, very interesting case. This Dr. Ravi Kumar from Andhra Pradesh, Rajahmundry, he has taken the trouble of giving the case summary. Good evening, 45 years female, uncontrolled asthma, diabetes, asthma exacerbation, aspergillus specific IgE is elevated, HRCT central bronchiectasis, eosinophils normal, PFT restriction, total IgE normal, sputum culture showed Klebsiella, diffuse bronchi, and prednisolone started at 0.5 milligram per kg, antibiotics, ICS, LABA after 2 months, complaining of facial edema, still wheezy. I should change to itraconazole only or continue prednisolone, itraconazole, and what is the itraconazole duration of treatment? I think Dr. Ravi has taken pains to discuss about his patient. I think the panelists agree on what he has done, giving antibiotic, giving steroids, right doses, a very typical ABPA patient with all the characteristic, clinical, radiological. Yes, I think there is a role here because of the diabetes and patient having exacerbation role for itraconazole. I think all of you agree on that. And if it is too weak, maybe give also in combination, as we said, you're not upfront, you know, later in this patient, and monitor the sugar and then take care of the diabetes. And am I right? You know, all of you agree on this difficult patient. All of us have this difficult patient, and many a time we wonder, these difficult patients, why don't we refer to one of our doctors whom we don't like? Yeah. So our dear friend Chatterjee is asking, how common is ABPA in patients not having asthma or similar obstructive airway disease? Not asthma. I think cystic fibrosis is one, and COPD is another. COPD.
And post-tuberculosis obstruction, that is the main
thing. So these are some patients with a pre-existing, any lung disease, for example, they are prone. And as Ravi in his introduction showed, that colonization occurs in patients whose lungs are or having a problem before this. Your experience of using biological treatment for ABPA, I think I mentioned one patient where I've used all three in this patient. Hopefully he will do well. He says he's better. I'm reassuring him that the third dose will be crucial. You wait for the third dose. He's already saying what is important, Shweta and Abhay here and other, is that, when you have an advanced disease, even though the eosinophil will come down to zero, but the symptoms will still be there because they already have a bronchiectasis, some atelectasis. Yes. So you won't, really find significant improvement in them. Maybe exacerbations will be better. The steroid doses are not there. What do you think on this? Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
it's because the disease has already progressed now.
Absolutely.
The lung damage has already been set in.
Yeah.
So, yeah, once the patient is in stage 5 or
6,
steroid dependent, or the we can say stage 6, when there is extensive damage already occurred. The patient has already got extensive bronchiectasis. Now this patient, apart from the ABPA, this patient may be getting a secondary bacterial infection,
yes,
particularly
yes,
pseudomonas. And okay, these patients, rather than ABPA fungus as such, the secondary bacterial infection is bothering him. So this patient needs to have a good physiotherapy. They should have a good hypertonic saline nebulization if required. If the lung is collapsing frequently, we can do a quick therapeutic bronchoscopy lavage and remove the secretions, give good physiotherapy. And there are various instruments like that we used to use, that flute. I don't know, it is not available in the market.
Excellent.
So it gives good vibration inside, and it helps in removing the secretions. You can add mucinec in this patient. So this antibiotics needs to be given. You can give a empirical macrolides. In some trials has been done to give macrolides for this patient for a period of 24 weeks and control the pseudomonas secondary bacterial infections in these patients.
Okay.
So this can be tried.
Yeah. Okay. I think I have just few more minutes. Am I right? And you can tell me when to stop. There are many questions, but I'll ask this very interesting question from Dr. Sanjay Kumar Behera from Odisha, Katak. How to diagnose invasive aspergillosis in an ABPA patient and mode of treatment from this? Anybody can take except me.
Ravi
is quiet. Let's wake him up.
No, sir. Believe me, this is a very tough question, sir. I think, first of all, invasive aspergillosis is a very fulminant condition, sir. And if a patient lands up in severe sepsis, then we can automatically understand that the ABPA might be going on to invasive aspergillosis. We might need to do lavage, send cultures, take blood cultures. We need to aggressively treat them with intravenous antifungal combination, sir.
You need to rule out the any immunocompromised state. Now yeah. This patient has now progressed to invasive aspergillosis, so we need to rule out any immunocompromised. And then galactomannan may have a role in this patient.
I was coming to that.
That may be bile or serum. Yes.
In ABPA may not have a role.
Yes. Sir.
And good. In this invasive one, yes. And also here there is a role for doing a biopsy and demonstrating
tissue biopsy, histopathological diagnosis.
Pathologically that it has invaded the tissue, and that's how you can diagnose. Nice question. Very good question.
Basically, we can plan, even Dr. Ritesh has suggested that these patients who are not responding to all of the above treatment, we can give inhaled amphotericin B and particularly liposomal amphotericin B, because the conventional amphotericin B may cause surfactant deficiency. So we can give a liposomal or lipid emulsion nebulization after every twice a month and for a period of 2 to 3 months and see how symptomatically the patient is improving.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. And there's one interesting question. Dr. Virendra from Maharashtra, again, Aurangabad. Is IC, these are all because these are all Dr. Abhay's friends who are asking these tough questions. So is ICS itself a predisposing factor for aspergillosis? Inhaled corticosteroids itself.
Sir, it is mentioned, it's a therapy, sir, but at the same time, it may be a risk factor if the patient does not follow the proper precaution of rinsing his mouth after taking the inhaled corticosteroids.
So that's commonly with candida, but as you said, sometimes you can, you know, so it's important oral hygiene after taking inhaled corticosteroids to this. How many minutes do you have? Is there anything, Ravi?
I think we are practically done, sir. One important is we have almost 941 logins to our webinar, sir.
Okay, I have very popular panelists here. That's why there's so many who are, you know, participating in this. I think we have done with this. Somebody is saying all the best to amazing moderator and panelists. Thank you. Thank you. Should we use both antifungal corticosteroids, similar mucoid? Okay. I think we have done with most of the question. Thank you for participating and actively asking all these questions, probing questions, difficult questions, easy questions, and case reports that you probably wanted to discuss. In fact, I mentioned to one of my patients whom I saw absolutely asymptomatic individual this morning and who has a 4000 IG that I'm going to discuss and then ask if there is anything I should do, asymptomatic, absolutely light. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
CCI, the coordinators who put in so much effort, week after week to have this webinar for last few years. Shweta taking all the initiative. Abhay, thank you. And of course, Ravi, all the time he's there for us. He's there from morning 7 o'clock wishing us for the webinar and of course guiding and then doing the introduction, nicely introduced the topic, and it went very well, and the flow of events after he did that. And Nikhil, the in-house radiologist, thank you so much. You went into the details of all the features of radiological features of the X-ray to start with, the CT scan, and then followed by other tests. Thank you so much, and thank you everyone who's part of this webinar, and thanks to all the participating doctors. And good night. And if there's anything to say as a last word, welcome. Thank you so much. I enjoyed moderating this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ravi, sir.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you, Ravi.
Good night, all.